Hachette Audio presents Joy at Work, Organizing Your Professional Life. Written by Marie Kondo and Scott Sonenshein. Read by Dan Woren and Brittany Ishibashi. Dedication. To my family, my home, and all the things that support me and spark joy in my life. With gratitude, Marie Kondo.
To my mom and dad, I finally learned to clean up. Scott Sonenshein. Notes to the reader. Although we collaborated on the entire contents of this book, each of us took primary responsibility for half of the writing. Marie's voice is in the introduction and chapters 1, 2, 3, and 11. Scott's voice is in chapters 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. The stories and examples from this book are from real people. Sometimes the names have been altered to protect their identities.
Introduction. Is your desk always buried under piles of documents? Yikes! Where's the report I have to submit tomorrow? Do you have a never-ending backlog of emails no matter how often you check them? About the email I sent you yesterday. What email? Is your schedule packed with appointments with people you don't even want to see? Are you carrying on like this every day because you've forgotten what you really wanted to do? Do you find it hard to make decisions? Are you asking yourself, is this all life's about? Just checking things off a to-do list? Isn't there some way to restore order to my job, my career, my life? If any of these apply to you, there's one solution. Tidy up. This book is not just about how to tidy up your workspace. It's about how to put in order both the physical and non-physical aspects of your job, including your digital data, time, decision-making, and networks, and how to spark joy in your career. Many people feel defeated at the mere suggestion of tidying up. I can't possibly make time for that. I'm far too busy already, they protest. There are too many decisions I need to make to even think of tidying, some say, while others claim, I've already tried it. I sorted all my documents and now they're just a mess again. Quite a few people don't believe they can find joy in their job. I'm stuck in useless meetings all day long. Tidying's never going to change that, they insist. Besides, too many things are out of my hands. There's no way work can be joyful. In fact, however, it's tidying up properly that makes it possible to spark joy at work. Since the age of 5, I've been fascinated by tidying. I pursued this subject right through my school years and went on to take my first steps as a tidying consultant at the age of 19 while still at university. The KonMari method arose from my experiences of teaching people how to tidy up. My approach has two distinct features. It's simple but effective, ensuring you'll never revert to clutter, and it uses a unique selection criterion, choosing what sparks joy. When we ask ourselves, does this spark joy? We reconnect with our inner self and discover what's really important to us. The result is a lasting change in behavior that sets life on a positive track. I introduce this method in The Life-Changing Magic of Tidying Up. Translated into 40 languages, it has sold a combined total of more than 12 million copies. For the past few years, I've been busy sharing my method worldwide. During this process, one question has come up repeatedly. How can we tidy up the workspace and spark joy at work? Most people see me as a specialist in tidying homes, not as someone with expertise in tidying workspaces, let alone in career development. While working for a Japanese company, however, I spent most of my spare time teaching company executives how to tidy their offices. Even people at the firm where I worked began asking me for advice. It was because I became so busy with these lessons that I finally decided to quit my job and launch my career as an independent consultant. My trained consultants continue to offer lessons and lectures on tidying the workplace using the KonMari method. They share with each other the knowledge and experience they gain and fine-tune the content accordingly. Through this process, it has become clear how much tidying the workplace improves performance and enhances the joy we get from our work. For example, clients have told us that it has boosted their sales performance by as much as 20%, increased efficiency to the point where they were able to leave work 2 hours earlier, and helped them to reassess the meaning of their job, rekindling their passion for it. We've seen countless examples of how tidying up can improve one's work life, both materially and psychologically. Just as tidying the home sparks joy in our lives, tidying the workplace sparks joy in our work, helping us to become more organized and achieve better results. This book introduces the secrets of that process. Of course, not everything at work can be evaluated on the basis of whether it sparks joy. There are company rules to follow, superiors who make decisions that affect our work, and coworkers with whom we collaborate. Nor is tidying our physical workspace enough to make our jobs go smoothly. We can truly spark joy in our work life only when we have put every aspect of it in order, including emails, digital data, work-related tasks, and meetings. That's where my co-author Scott comes in. As an organizational psychologist and a chaired business school professor at Rice University, Scott has been at the forefront of research to create more rewarding and joyful careers. His work covers a broad range of subjects, including how to achieve a more positive and meaningful work life, become more effective and productive at work, and problem solve in business. Based on the results of this research, his best-selling book, Stretch, shows how we can find success and satisfaction at work by making better use of what we already have, whether skills, knowledge, or items. All this makes him a leading expert on how to spark joy at work. Throughout this book, Scott provides cutting-edge scientific research and data on tidying and provides practical lessons on tidying up the non-physical aspects of work. In Chapter 1, we share data related to tidying that we're sure will get you motivated. Chapters 2 and 3 cover how to tidy your workspace. Chapters 4 through 9 look at tidying digital data, time, decisions, networks, meetings, and teams. Chapter 10 covers how to multiply the impact of tidying at your company. The final chapter transcends the framework of tidying, suggesting actions you can take to spark even more joy in your daily work and the type of mindset and approach that lead to a joyful career. This chapter includes stories from my own experience that are intended to get you thinking about how you can spark joy in your work life. We hope you'll use this book as the master key to a joyful career. Chapter 1. Why tidy? What's the first thing that greets you when you get to the office on Monday morning? For many, it's a desk covered in things, things, and more things. Piles of documents, random paperclips, unopened letters delivered who knows when, unread books, and a laptop plastered with sticky note reminders. And beneath their desk are often bags of promotional giveaways from customers. I'm sure most people heave a deep sigh at the sight and wonder how they'll ever get anything done when their desk is such a mess. Aki, an office worker at a real estate agency, was one of those who suffered from a messy desk. Even though it wasn't that big, the top was only about as wide as her arm span, and it had only 3 drawers, she could never find anything in it. Before a meeting, she was always frantically searching for her glasses, her pen, or a folder, and she often had to reprint her documents and materials when she failed to unearth them. Many times, she became fed up and resolved to organize her desk, but come evening, she would be too tired and put it off until tomorrow, piling all the documents she had used that day on one side before heading home. Of course, the next day she would end up searching through that pile for the materials she needed before she could even begin tackling her work. By the time she finally got started, she was exhausted. "Sitting at that messy desk was totally depressing," she told me. Unfortunately, she had good reason to feel this way. Various studies show that messy conditions cost us far more than we could ever imagine, and in multiple ways. In a survey of 1,000 working American adults, 90% felt that clutter had a negative impact on their lives. The top reasons they gave were lowered productivity, a negative mindset, reduced motivation, and diminished happiness. Clutter also adversely affects health. According to a study by scientists at UCLA, being surrounded by too many things increases cortisol levels, a primary stress hormone. Chronically high levels of cortisol can make us more susceptible to depression, insomnia, and other mental disorders, as well as such stress-related physical disorders as heart disease, hypertension, and diabetes. In addition, recent psychology research shows that a messy environment taxes the brain. When surrounded by clutter, our brains are so busy registering all the things around us that we can't focus on what we should be doing in the moment, such as tackling the work on our desk or communicating with others. We feel distracted, stressed, and anxious, and our decision-making ability is impaired. Clutter, it seems, is a magnet for misery. In fact, the data show that people like me, who get excited by the sight of a messy room and can't wait to tidy up, are the exception. But it's not just individuals who are affected. Clutter is bad for business, too. Have you ever spent hours looking for something at the office? Or even lost it completely? Almost half of office workers report mislaying one important work-related item a year. It might be a file folder, calculator, a memory drive, a briefcase, a laptop, or a cell phone. Not only does replacing lost items cost money, but losing them in the first place causes emotional stress and creates unnecessary waste that damages the environment. But the greatest loss is the time spent looking for them. Data show that the search for lost things adds up to an average of 1 workweek per year per employee. In a span of 4 years, that comes to a whole month. In the United States alone, this loss in productivity when converted to cash amounts to an estimated $89 billion U.S. dollars annually. This is more than double the combined profit of the world's 5 largest corporations. These figures are staggering, but this is the reality. The effects of clutter can be devastating. Still, there's no need to worry. All these problems can be solved by tidying up. How tidying my workspace changed my life. After graduating from university, I got a job at a staffing agency in the corporate sales department. My euphoria at joining the workforce, however, was short-lived. Although it's only natural for new hires to experience difficulties when they first start, my sales performance never seemed to improve. Of the 15 people newly employed that year, I was always in the bottom 3. I arrived at the office early, spent hours on the phone trying to make appointments with prospective clients, kept those appointments I did manage to make, and made lists of more potential customers in between. In the evening, I grabbed a quick bowl of noodles at a shop in our building, then returned to my desk to prepare materials. I seemed to be working all the time, yet I never got results. One day, after another discouraging round of sales calls, I put down the receiver with a deep sigh and bowed my head. Staring dejectedly at the top of my desk, I realized with a start that it was a complete mess. Scattered around my keyboard were a pile of outdated sales lists, a half-written contract, a paper cup with some tea I hadn't finished, a shriveled-up tea bag, a week-old bottle of water, scraps of paper on which I had scrawled random sales tips from my coworkers, an unread business book someone had recommended, a pen missing its cap, a stapler with which I had planned to staple together some papers but had forgotten. I could not believe my eyes. How could this have happened? I had been working as a tidying consultant since I was in university, yet despite my confidence in my tidying skills, I had been so swamped with my new job that I no longer had time to do any consulting and had even become lax in my tidying habits at home. Somehow, I had lost touch with my inner tidying geek. No wonder I wasn't having any success at work. Shocked, I came into the office at 7 the next morning to tidy my desk. Marshaling all the knowledge and skills I had honed over the years, I finished within an hour.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.